Hello, everyone. James Lawrence here. I want to bring to you a teaching that is on a subject I've covered before, but I want you to know that I'm going to have a very positive side I'm going to start off with, and then I'm going to talk about the negative side, and that is the once saved, always saved doctrine. Now, a person actually wrote me on my comments and said, "What do you think of this doctrine?" And let me tell you what I started off with. I said, I know this sounds like a cop-out answer, but I'm actually about 85% in belief of OSAS, once saved, always saved. And I hold out about 15% of non-belief in unconditional eternal security, which is the other term for it. I say this because even with Jesus saying that he will not lose any who call on him, accepting his lordship, and that those the Father gives him cannot be plucked out of his hand. He also gives warnings in this area. Before I mention the warnings, I want to read passages that show we are eternally secure in Christ. Those are the key words. Have you received Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, believing that he did die for you on the cross of crucifixion, being beaten and whipped and tortured on his way to the cross, dying on the cross, and then being placed in a tomb afterward, but raised from the dead 3 days later? Okay, if you believe what Jesus did for you in obtaining you salvation, if you will receive it, then you can be in Christ by acceptance of him as Lord and Savior. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Okay, I want to read John chapter 6, verse 37 through 40. Jesus said, "All that the Father giveth me shall come to me, and him that cometh to me I will in no wise cast out. For I came down from heaven not to do mine own will, but the will of him that sent me. And this is the Father's will which hath sent me, that of all which he hath given me I should lose nothing, but should raise it up again at the last day. And this is the will of him that sent me, that every one which seeth the Son and believeth on him may have everlasting life, and I will raise him up at the last day." Now, some people want to put a really burdensome, if you ask me, definition of what it is to be saved. And there's all kinds of intellectual things you have to understand before you can be saved. Not true. It's the simple preaching of the gospel. Jesus said so. But it says here, and this is the will of him that sent me, the Father's will, that everyone which seeth the Son and believeth on him may have everlasting life, and I will raise him up at the last day. So is it belief, or is it a lot more? Oh no, you have to consider whether or not you're one of the, you know, that you've been chosen for salvation. Folks, he's chosen everyone. For Jesus was sent to the whole world, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. Yes, but there are other scriptures that say, well, you need to interpret scriptures in light of what they all say. And then you can understand that the ones you're talking about that you think mean that you have to be chosen specially or something like that very likely mean something else, especially when there's so many that talk about God offering salvation to all of mankind. Jesus said, if I be lifted up on the cross, signifying what type of death he would die, he said it before, of course he went to the cross, he said that if I be lifted up, that I will draw all men unto me. But will all men receive Christ? No, there will be people who will be lost for eternity. They will be not saved. They will not be in Christ, the key words I just mentioned a while ago. So therefore, it takes someone who is saved, but it's also, in my opinion, being in Christ means that you remain in Christ and you do not venture into some other type of very bad false doctrine. And do people do that? Well, Paul warned in Galatians chapter 1, verses 8 and 9, that he said, first of all, he told these people, "I marvel at you because you're so soon removed from him, that called you into the gospel of Christ unto another gospel, which is not another, but some would trouble you and would pervert the gospel of Christ. And then he talks about, but if we or an angel from heaven ever comes to you and says, here's how the gospel really is, and then you fall for it. You know, that's what it sounds like he's saying there, is that I marvel that you're so soon removed from him that called you into the grace of Christ unto another gospel. But he warned that anyone who preaches another gospel, that they are accursed. Okay, so are there other gospels out there? Yes, yes, absolutely. Okay, John chapter 10, verse 27 says, my sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. And I give unto them eternal life, and they shall never perish, neither shall any man pluck them out of my hand. Praise God. Hallelujah. Jesus is going to keep us. Okay, Romans 11, 29. For the gifts and calling of God are without repentance. If God saves you, he's never sorry that he saved you. Now, can he be grieved by you because you go into sinfulness of some sort? Yes, the Bible says so. Can you go so far into grieving God that his spirit will not always strive with you? Well, if you keep on rejecting him and saying, Lord, I want this, not you, then that is always a possibility, in my opinion. But I think it's rare, and that's why I say I have a 15% withholding of belief that once saved, always saved is true. And you say you're teetering. No one can be a fence rider and be a true Christian. You know what? If you go that far with there being scriptures this powerful on both sides, some I'm going to read from the other side here in a moment, but this is the side I like the most, and I do not like to believe that there's any possibility of losing salvation. But is that a running from responsibility of at least considering that it's a possibility? Kind of yes. Yes, it is. It's wanting to believe what you want to believe rather than what some of the scriptures are saying, seemingly in no uncertain terms. But could I be wrong? I could be wrong. You could be wrong. Everyone else could be wrong in one way or the other about this particular doctrine. So I pray God that I'm giving it to you as truthfully as I possibly know how. You say if you had any doubts, you shouldn't teach it. Well, I was asked. I was asked to comment, and I did, and I tweaked it, the comment, and I added these scriptures actually in writing. So I thought, I must use these for notes. This doesn't happen just willy-nilly. But whatever that term is, that just haphazardly some things come to you. Well, you know, the devil can... Okay, let's not get ridiculous. Now let me read the next one. Jude chapter 1, verse 24 says, now unto him that is able to keep you from falling, God, and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Okay. Now my next scripture, still talking about these positive scriptures. Philippians chapter 1, verse 6, being confident of this very thing, that he which begun a good work in you will perform it until the day of Jesus Christ. So when we're resurrected and we're standing before God and we're in his presence forever, of course, then that will be the completion of God's predestining us to be conformed. That will be the last of God's conforming us into the image of his Son, which we have our own identities. And yet, it's just like when God said, let us make man in our image and our likeness, and let them have dominion. Well, was Adam and Eve in their own identity as well as being in the very image and likeness of God? Yes. So therefore, that's how I would answer that. Now, the last one I want to read on this part of it is Romans chapter 8, verse 38 and 39, which says, for I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Hallelujah. Praise God. Now, here's how some people will will say this in regard to saying, yes, that is all truth, praise God, but what if the person, their self, is the covenant breaker, the salvation covenant? Now, some people say, it's not a covenant, it's God's salvation. Folks, listen, when God is offering something to man, it says, if you will meet me here, receiving my son, I will save you. That's a covenant. It's a salvation covenant. I've heard it said that way for over 40 years, people calling it that. So that's correct. It says, in my reply to this man who asked me this question about the once saved, always saved doctrine, I did mention these warnings earlier, which include scriptures such as the ones found in Jesus' letters to the churches in Asia Minor in the book of Revelation. These letters were sent to these churches supernaturally, of course, by Jesus, by his messenger, which may have been John. Now, people are in disagreement over this, and I've heard different messages say different things about it, just like as it is with many doctrines. But to speculate on just kind of a detail like this is not taking away or adding to God's word. Okay. It could have been John, the revelator, the apostle who was on the Isle of Patmos and actually penned down the book of Revelation as God gave it to him. Or possibly angels. It says, sent by my messengers. Into the angel of the church of the Laodiceans and so forth. The angel of. Now some people say, well, it's angels. How would the angel then give a scroll? It's possible. Give a scroll to someone there. Or is angel in the sense it is used in many passages in the scriptures, meaning messenger? Is it John? Is it John who wrote these and said, Jesus hath said this to you? Okay? It could be additional prophets. It could be apostles or pastors of the churches. I'm not sure. So let me just say that. But he states in these letters things such as Christians, I just mentioned Laodicea, being lukewarm. Each church represents groups within Christianity that can be this way. Because these certain Laodiceans were neither cold, meaning to be in a state of being able to be proselytized, in other words, made converts, and that they are not hot either, meaning they are not fully committed to Christ as Savior and Lord. He will spew them, he says, out of his mouth. That's in Revelation 3, 16 through 18. Let me read it. It says, did I read Revelation 3, 16 through 19? Possibly here. Okay, so then because thou art lukewarm and neither cold nor hot, I will spew thee out of my mouth, because thou sayest, I am rich and increased with goods and have need of nothing, and knowest not that thou art wretched and miserable and poor and blind and naked. As many as I love, I rebuke and chasten. Be zealous, therefore, and repent. Okay, so he's writing to a church. This is a church full of people that are born again in Jesus Christ. And he's telling them to repent because they've begun to ride the rail. They're between being committed to God and not being committed to him. And he said, repent. He said, as many as I love his people, I rebuke and chasten. Therefore, be zealous and repent. Or be zealous, therefore, and repent. I'll put it in the right order there, being that it's the book of Revelation. He also warned certain Christians in Sardis and other ones too. Now, I'm just naming some of these. Each one had a warning of some type. He also warns them in Sardis that if they overcome the world, the sin nature is what that is speaking of. Now listen, I'm not trying to interpret that. What I'm saying is the sin nature is in the world. That's where you find it. That's where you go to fulfill the sin nature into the world system, which is very sinful, thoroughly. Okay, so anyway, if they overcome the world through ongoing sanctification, now that's not the same as works. It's being submitted to God as you walk with Jesus Christ. And he is the one who gives you a change in your spirit from glory to glory. There can't be a greater glory than being glorified in the resurrection. But glory to glory, meaning in this life, God gives us more and more sanctification as we walk with him. You certainly can't do that if you don't walk with him. So some people will be more sanctified, obviously. I mean, I don't think that's really something that needs to be argued when they go to heaven than other people, because he told them that they certainly did need to be sanctified ongoingly, and that their names would not be blotted out of the book of life if they would overcome the world. Let me read that one, Revelation 3:5. He that overcometh, the same shall be clothed in white raiment, and I will not blot out his name out of the book of life, but I will confess his name before my Father and before his angels. Yes, he did say it, blotted out. He said the out twice. I will not blot out his name out of the book of life. So therefore, and you know, I once posted a video and I said, what do you think of this scripture? And boy, I guess I should never have done that. We can't discuss things. We can't discuss them because it's wrong to sometimes. Other scriptures, such as one found in 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 20 through 22, talk about what very much sounds like people who were born again in Christ, returning to sinful worldliness and having a worse outcome than they had at any time previous in their lives. 2 Peter 2, verse 20 through 22, for if after they have escaped the pollutions of the world, through the knowledge of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, they are again entangled therein and overcome, the latter end is worse with them than the beginning. For it had been better for them not to have known the way of righteousness than after they have known it, to turn from the holy commandment delivered unto them. But it has happened unto them according to the true proverb, the dog is turned again to his own vomit, and the sow that was washed to her wallowing in the mire. So the dog goes and begins to eat up the old raunchy stuff again, and the sow was washed clean from the mud and the mire, and then goes back and wallows in it again. Okay, lastly, I want to talk about a scripture in Hebrews chapter 6, verse 4 through 8. It's another warning similar to the one that I just read in Peter's second epistle. And there are other verses and passages like these I've just read as well. So I've only read a portion of them, and yet there's many more that say both sides, from both sides. So it seems to be a very definitive warning of toward those who would walk away from the salvation covenant I mentioned earlier with God. He's never the covenant breaker, but men have always been the ones who can dishonor God. Look at the history in the Bible, of the Bible. Okay, I realize in Calvinism, for example, okay, I had to say this to the guy because I was wondering if he might be, and he may not have been at all, but I realize in Calvinism, the perseverance of the saints doctrine is basically the once saved, always saved. But there are churches of many denominations who believe in the doctrine of unconditional eternal security, once saved, always saved, that are not of Calvinism or of the Reformed churches. So I certainly would not try to make that claim. I know it's not true, that it's not just Calvinists who believe in the once saved, always saved. No, no. Many do. And like I say, as for me, I mostly believe that you cannot lose salvation. But you know, there are scriptures such as work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. What's there to fear in salvation? Is that just talking about a reverence for God? Okay. And there's one where, is it Peter that's maybe, I don't remember, Paul maybe. But anyway, either one, they said to the effect of, so you believe in God, that is good. Even the devils believe and tremble. Okay, but he's talking about, don't just be a believer, but be one who, maybe it's in James, I can't remember, be one who actually acts on your salvation, and you love God with all your heart all the time, and then you love others as you would have them to love you. And that, Jesus said, is the two commandments that sum up everything. Everything the law and the prophets ever contained in it is contained in those two commandments he gave: to love the Lord God with all your heart, soul, mind, spirit, body. And then the other one he said is very much like it: to love your neighbor as you would have them to love you. Okay, love them as you would love yourself. So in other words, you are taking the image and likeness of God on earth, which is manifest in all people, and you are loving God through them, and also loving God directly, your prayer life, you know, mostly, and your attendance with other Christians in church and so forth. That's how you are showing your love for God. Are these works? Would a person like to get into an argument like that? Oh yes, they would love it to pieces. But let me just say this: how can loving someone be a work? It should be of great pleasure to love someone in a deep love that you know is real. Okay? I'm sorry. I didn't mean... Okay. This is the last one. Hebrews 6, 4 through 8. I didn't just read that, did I? I don't think so. For it is impossible for those who were once enlightened and have tasted of the heavenly gift and were made partakers of the Holy Ghost and have tasted the good word of God and the powers of the world to come, if they shall fall away, to renew them again unto repentance, seeing they crucify to themselves the Son of God afresh and put him to an open shame. For the earth which drinketh in the rain that cometh oft upon it and bringeth forth herbs meet for them by whom it is dressed receiveth blessing from God. But that which beareth thorns and briars is rejected and is nigh unto cursing, whose end is to be burned. Okay, so that's what that scripture continues on into. Okay, so there is a great deal more in the scriptures, as I said, on this subject. I would just say to walk in God's love toward him and toward your fellow man as a Christian, and you will be kept eternally secure. I'll remind that the scripture in Jude that I read earlier says God is able to keep those who are in Christ from falling. And it uses that word, who is the one who is able to keep us from falling. So if you never reject God in your life, you can be assured that the eternal life, the security for eternal life, and these scriptures I read first that are joyous, give us that great joy and assurance in God, will be true for you. And God will give you that great hope that's spoken of in Titus chapter 2, verse 13. It says that great hope is Jesus Christ. So be saved today if you're not already. I do pray that even though I've kept this fairly short on purpose, that I have covered things as I should. Please know that I've just read scriptures from both sides that people can stand on, literally, because they are solid scriptures. But how can the Bible be contradicting itself? Well, you might have to look at one factor involved in it. And I said this earlier, the key words are in Christ. Okay? Thank you for hearing me. God bless you. And I will talk to you again soon. This is James Lawrence saying goodbye for now.